been in a dangerous zone, dangerous, risky places or uncertain times, uncertain places? Yeah, definitely. I have been in many, but being raised up in Jammu Kashmir, you know, it's an area full of risk and all, and people ask why you have settled in that place, but it's all God's plan that I was raised there and my parents are still pastoring the church over there. But in all those situations, God is there to take care of us. Now, I just want to give you an example of one of the times, I think 8 or 9 months back, I was in a situation like that. I was asked to drop our children at a certain place to play with other children, and then I was supposed to come back. And I was just new to the freeway. And that place where I went was totally new. And it was around 5:30, and we were supposed to come back. I was alone in my car. Children had gone to with somebody else. One of the brothers, because he loved me, he said, "Pastor, you follow me." And he was driving his car. I was following him. And, you know, he thought that I knew all these freeways, 2, 10, 15 and all. So he was assuming that, and I was following him. And within few minutes, he vanished. And I was all alone in the freeway. And I don't know what to do. And you cannot stop in American freeways. You have to drive. And within few minutes, I sensed that I am in the wrong direction. And I don't know where to get in. And I looked at my mobile, and it was almost dying. And the batteries were dying, and I could not put the GPS also. Then all of a sudden, in the radio, in the FM, there was a song which was singing, "I need you, oh Lord, I need you every hour." And said, that was the prayer actually inside me. I didn't plan that song, somebody was singing. And then I somehow took an exit and reached the destination. I was really unhappy with that brother, but it was not his mistake. He thought that I knew, and I was in a very, very uncertain zone that day. But I learned how to drive after that. Praise God for that experience. Now, good tires are tested in unpleasant surfaces and various unpleasant climates. That's what the engineers do. And our God, our master engineer, tests his children in uncertain zones of our lives. And I want to bring your attention to one of the very, very known passages from Synoptic Gospels, maybe because we are studying Synoptic Gospel in Loma Linda. I want to take your attention to Matthew chapter 8, verses 18 to 27. Matthew chapter 8, verses 18 to 27. Those of us who are taking down notes can also write the parallel passages. Mark chapter 4, verses 35 to 41. Luke chapter 8, verses 22 to 25. I'm going to read from Matthew chapter 8, verses 18 to 27. When Jesus saw the crowd around him, he gave orders to cross to the other side of the lake. Then a teacher of the law came to him and said, "Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go." Jesus replied, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." Another disciple said to him, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." But Jesus told him, "Follow me and let the dead bury their own dead." Then he got into the boat and his disciples followed him. Without warning, a furious storm came up on the lake so that the waves swept over the boat. But Jesus was sleeping. The disciples went and woke him, saying, "Lord, save us. We are going to drown." He replied, "You of little faith, why are you so afraid?" Then he put up and rebuked the winds and the waves, and it was completely calm. The men were amazed and asked, "What kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him." Now you see the parallel passages in Mark and Luke. I will come to those passages when and wherever it is needed. The Lord God is actually teaching us how to deal in uncertain zones. So my topic of my message this afternoon will be zones or uncertain zones that stretches your faith level. Now, as I told you that I had a difficult experience, we do face all kinds of uncertain situations in our lives. But how does God demonstrate his love for us by letting us into those uncertain zones, uncertain times? First thing which I want to tell you is that the story is a very familiar story where Jesus had ordered his disciples to go to the other shore, and they were in the boat and in the Sea of Galilee, and that was late afternoon according to various scholars. Now let me tell something about the Sea of Galilee, then only you'll understand how difficult and risky that zone is. By the way, Galilee is around 33 miles in circumference. And lengthwise it is 13 miles, and breadthwise it is 8.1 miles. And an average depth of around 141 feet. And it's around 64.4 square miles. And we should know that this is the lowest fresh water body on the face of the earth. And it takes almost 2 hours to cross at an average. And it's a risky and uncertain afternoon. Why do I say that? It's because this particular lake is surrounded by mountains. And on the western side, you have the Mediterranean Sea. On the eastern side, you have the hot desert. And there are mountains which are almost 2,000 feet high from the sea level. And in some part of the year, it is snow-covered. Whenever it is snow-covered, there is a phenomenon of cold air drainage. Now, let me explain to you what is that cold air drainage. You know, in the mountaintop, where there are wind, where there are snow, the air is cold and dense and heavy. And you know, what happens is it drains down once in a while in the afternoons to the sea level, where the air is not that dense. It is expanded and warm. And when the cold air from the mountain drains down and hits the sea level, there is a kind of a disturbance in the air pressure. And because of that air pressure, there is a kind of a wind that is created there. And it happens all of a sudden. And this is what happened in this. Without warning, there is a wind. And it will be so furious that sometimes you cannot imagine for next 2 hours what's going to happen. And so if the wind is stronger, the waves will be higher. If the wind is going to be for longer time, then the waves will be higher. And that is the kind of situation the disciples were in. And that was late afternoon. Probably they had a long ministry. And that is the reason why Jesus was very tired and he had to go to sleep. He doesn't sleep usually, but this is the only place where we see him sleeping. And usually, you know, disciples must be sleeping during the ministry time. Jesus was ministering. That's what happened with some of the places. Pastor is preaching, not this case. Pastor is preaching and the believers are sleeping, not here, somewhere else. And another thing why it was risky was some scholars say that this boat was oversized. Usually the boat takes 12 people. Now here it is probably 15 people. Now you may say, how that 15 has come, 12 disciples. And moreover, it was not the boat of one of the disciples. They just got into a boat. They wanted to cross over. And in every boat, there's a sailor and a crew member who will help in sailing. Plus Jesus makes it 15. So this boat is overcrowded and the disciples are not prepared. They are in unprepared costume. you know, they had a long kind of dress and they cannot walk and they cannot swim, even if there is a risk. So you remember in John chapter 21, verse 7, where he was fishing in the water and Jesus looked at him, and when he found out that it is Jesus, he wrapped himself, because that's the way they get into the sea. But here all the disciples were well-dressed because they had gone for a ministry and they had come back. So they were not prepared to jump into the water even if there is a risk. So it was a high-risk situation and it was a high-risk zone. And I told you it is late afternoon. But God is facilitating uncertain zones in their lives. Isn't it interesting? Our God desires and he wants us to take into those situations. As a loving father, sometimes we think that our children should not get hurt. You know, especially in the Eastern world. But then, as a loving father, we should allow our children to get into some kind of situations with their eye on them. This is what our God does. And his children are supposed to experience such kind of situations. You remember there's a situation like this for Jeremiah. Let me read what Jeremiah complains to God when he went through that. Jeremiah chapter 12. Actually, it starts from verse number 1 to 5. What does God tell him? Jeremiah is saying that. You see, let me read to save time. Let me start from verse number 1. You are always righteous, O Lord, when I bring a case before you. Yet I would speak with you about your justice. Why does the way of wicked prosper? Why do all the faithless live at ease? You have planted them and they have taken root. They grow and bear fruit. You are always on their lips, but far from their hearts. Yet you know me, O Lord. You see me and test my thoughts about you. Drag them off like sheep to be butchered. Look at what Jeremiah says. Set them apart for the day of slaughter. How long will the land lie parched and the grass in every field be withered? Because those who live in it are wicked. The animals and birds have perished. Moreover, the people are saying, he will not see what happens to us. What does God respond? Listen to verse number 5. If you have raced with men on foot and they have worn you out, how can you compete with horses? If you stumble in safe country, how will you manage in the thickets by Jordan? This is what God answers. That means God wants us to get into that kind of situation because he has so many things in his mind to teach us. Now, when God is taking us into that kind of situations, there are two types of people, two types of players. The first one, I call them as voluntary players. Now see that? Those people who are obedient and do not question God for that. Here also, when Jesus told them to go, Matthew chapter 8, we read that Jesus went into the boat and the disciples followed them. And some of them, at least half of them, are fishermen, and they knew that it is not a safe time to go. And there could be dangers at that time. But we don't find anybody complaining or saying, Jesus, Master, let's not go now. Probably that was a clear sky and there was nothing there. But they could have assumed. But we see that they were ready to go. They never questioned. And this is what happens. You know, the real disciples would just follow the Master. They will not question. They might have thoughts in their mind, but they know that their Master knows the best for them. Even in our lives, when we face difficulties, the Lord wants us to realize that whatever he does will be for our good, not for our harm. Now, the Bible says that he loves us and he has chosen us and he has done plans for us for our good, not to harm us. That's what the Lord does for us. So we have to be volunteer players and say, Lord, I am ready. Take me to the place where you want us to go. But there are another group of people whom usually I say pushpender kind of people. These are known as hesitant players. I want to use another word for that. They would not like to go at the orders of Jesus. Look at what Jesus says in chapter 8, verse 18. He's not suggesting them. Interesting to know in Matthew chapter 8, verse 18. When Jesus saw the crowd around him, he gave orders. He says, go, let's go. So it is an order from the Lord, but you know, some people, they do not want to take up the orders. And Matthew chapter 14, verse 22, we see that Jesus insisted his disciples to get into the boat. After a whole day of ministry, Jesus is asking them to get into the boat. It's a kind of a force, you know. Some people say that, you know, some children say, why do you force us? We are independent thinkers. Now, why do you want to force us like that? You know, that's the way the children are nowadays. I'm talking about children in general. Because they don't want to listen to parents. You know, parents, when they say, this is, Dad, we are in a different situation than yours. You are in a different old century. We are in a new situation. We know how to think. But children make such kind of comments because they think that they know everything. Then we tell them that we are almost, you know, we have a lot of experience and you guys do not know how to. So, you know, most of the parents would agree to me. But those children who are making that kind of statements, when they become parents, they will understand that. So let us bear with them till that time. Anyway, so this kind of situation, when the orders were given, they were not ready to go. Probably in some cases, we will say that it's actually getting into our freedom. But what is the kind of reaction when we get into that situation? I want to tell you, such group of people are in the training period. Training period. That's called as the practical training. And this is meant for this, every disciple. God wants every disciple to go through that training period and training kind of a practical training in their life. But I want to tell you that God, our God, is an omniscient God. He knows everything beforehand. Even though the climate was very clear, the sky was clear, even the meteorological department, probably if they had over there, they would say that it's not going to rain, it's not going to, you know, be, you know, kind of a bad weather when you go into the sea. But Jesus knew everything. He's an omniscient God. That is where I want to bring to the second point. That is the silence of an omniscient God. Jesus was asleep on the boat. That's interesting, isn't it? Can you sleep when the when you're in a boat and the, you know, kind of roaring kind of situation all around? I've been to this Sea of Galilee more than one year back, and I was sitting in the, that was a big ship probably, and there are so many other visitors in that, and I can see that we were just moving up and down, and you know, just totally undisturbed. It's kind of a disturbed kind of situation. You cannot be very calm there. So how can somebody sleep in that kind of situation? But you can't blame Jesus also, because he was ministering the whole day and he was very tired and he went to sleep. But even though he was sleeping, he knew everything. He's an omniscient God. Now, was it deliberate? Was he deliberately making, he was acting there as sleeping? I don't think. He was tired. But even if he was sleeping, he was aware of what is happening because he is the creator. Now, why did he keep it secret? He knew that within few minutes, the climatic situation is going to change. There'll be a sudden storm. But why did he keep that omniscient Jesus, why did he keep that secret from his disciples? That is interesting, isn't it? But I was thinking that silence is to facilitate you into the zone. If Jesus had told them, within 1 hour, you are going to face a furious storm, let me ask you, none of the disciples would have agreed to go with him. Although they are disciples, they would not listen to him. Because that's the way we are. Now, when your children were smaller, if you ask them to stand here and ask them to jump, they would jump. But if Roshan stands here now and asks his father, Rajesh calls him, come on, jump, he won't jump. Even though his father is strong, he won't jump, because as you grow older, you think and you have your own way of thinking. And this is what happened. If Jesus had told them this is going to be a big, difficult time, I don't think the disciples would have been ready to go. But I praise God that Jesus did not let them that to know that. Even when God asked Moses to get out of Egypt, he never told them that they're going to reach the Red Sea and going to face a problem. Only when they reached Red Sea, that is the time they looked up. If they had told the Israelites that we are going to face a Red Sea kind of situations, and the Egyptian army is going to come follow us, none of them would have listened to Moses. They would have killed Moses. Even that moment, they were almost ready to kill Moses, because that was a very sad situation. God sometimes does not tell us what is going to happen. We have to wait. And I want to tell you, you're in the safe hands of that omniscient God. He is there to protect you, even though he won't let you know that, but he is in control of that situation. He also wants to see our reaction. Silence is the test of our reaction, how we are going to react in that situation. He did not tell them anything, but while the ship was, you know, moving up and down and Jesus was sleeping, and he might have sensed that something is happening, but he was just keeping quiet. He wanted to know what was there in their heart. And you see how they reacted? They were very, very anxious and troubled in their heart. I want to tell you that these people were not normal people. They had been in the sea for several years. You know, Peter, John, and James, they were well versed of the situation there. They have seen many dangers in their life. But you see that now is the time when they were so anxious, so disturbed, and they reacted towards God. And sometimes that's happened. When such situation come in our lives, we ask God, why? Why did that happen to me? Why am I facing this kind of situation in my life? But God is not angry with you when you make a question, when you ask a question like that. He knows our nature. He loves us. But he will not answer you then. He's waiting for something to be. That's my message this afternoon. So here comes the next point, that is the secret of getting into the uncertain zone. The secrets are unveiled in the uncertain zones. He won't tell you when you have started ministry, when you are with the crowd. He won't tell you when you are sitting in the, you started your journey in the boat. But he will tell you when you are really facing that situation. Listen to that very carefully. The first thing which I want to tell you is that greater truths are taught away from distractions. Jesus wanted to teach them something. But if they had been with the crowd, he cannot tell them about that. Even if he tells them, they will not understand. That's why Jesus was, you know, once sharing the parable, and after the parable, they come and say that, Jesus, Master, we did not understand anything. Even the parables, they did not understand. How can they understand these deeper truths? So God has to take us to those uncertain times, uncertain places, away from the crowd. Away from the crowd. What does it mean? Crowd will give their own suggestions. When Jesus is teaching you certain things, if you have some comfortable friends with whom you are comfortable, they will actually not let you grow in that area. They will not let you understand that truth, the spiritual truth, because they will have all kinds of suggestions, all kinds of criticisms, all kinds of ideas in their mind. So Jesus takes us to lonely places. He takes us to a place where nobody is there to give you suggestions. Only the Lord is there to give suggestion. So this is what happens to many people in the Bible. Moses was the chosen vessel of God. But for 40 years, he was in the palace. God probably might have thought of teaching him certain things while he was in the palace. He gave him education, everything, but the real truth was not being, you know, immersed in his mind and heart and soul. So God had to take him to the wilderness, 40 years alone with God. And that is why on that day when he saw that burning bush, he came near. His intellect said, how is that possible that a green bush is burning and it's not getting burnt? And then the Lord said, I want to tell you certain truths. I'm the God of your father Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. This is what happened to David. Right after his anointing, if he had become the king, he would not understand, he would not have become a man with the heart of God. It took years, alone in the wilderness. Away from parents, away from friends, away from brothers and sisters. All with his sheep. During that time, God was teaching him those truths.
Paul was the same thing. After his conversion, he wasn't accepted by his own people.
He went to the Arabia, where he learned the greater truths of the God. Of God.
Last week, we were hearing about Elijah. God had to push him into that cave.
And that is where he heard the silent voice of God. Sometimes this happens. The uncertain zones exposes the maximum power of enemy. In Mark chapter 4, verse 37, we see that there was a great danger. They were in great danger. You know, when you are in that situation, what the enemy does is, he shows you how big he is. Look at the waves. Look at the situation you are in. And God allows that. God is silent. Let them see that first. He allows that.
You see the case of the Israelites when they were for 40 days facing Goliath? What do you see in 1 Samuel chapter 16 and 17? There was a description about the size of Goliath, the weapons of Goliath, and the way he shouts and screams.
That is the way devil tricks us.
He wants to show how big he is. And some people, by looking at it and seeing that and hearing that, get so discouraged, they are not able to see the God of theirs who is bigger than all these problems.
But David was able to see that.
David was able to see that. Mark chapter 4 verse 37 says that they were almost swamped, almost drowned.
But interesting, during that time, God prepares space for accommodating greater faith in us.
You know, for example, this is a bottle and it has got water. And somebody said it is half empty. But somebody else said, no, this is half full of water and half full of air. It's not empty. So our hearts are like this. There are other things which are not actually needed for us, or that will be a hindrance for our spiritual life, spiritual growth. And one of them is fear factor. And disciples, all of them were fearful.
But how did you know that they were fearful? How God wanted to prove that you have a fearful factor inside you. Peter and John and James, they were rough in the sense they were in the sea, and they were actually very brave, one way saying. You know, fishermen are usually brave. And I was told that we have read that in Kerala where there was a big flood. It was a fisherman who had rescued the most number of people. Not the Indian Army. Probably we appreciate Indian Army and other people. But the fishermen, the most courageous people. So Peter, John, they were courageous people. But even then, Jesus knew that in deep inside them, there is some fear factor hidden. And when is that exposed? When we are in that trying zone, uncertain zone.
In that kind of situation, God puts us so that he excuses out. First of all, he exposes the great fear that is inside you. Then he excuses out and makes space. For what? So that great faith can be incorporated into you. Faith will not come unless the fear factor is there.
Fear is the enemy of faith.
God wanted to take it out, squeeze it out. And that is possible only in this trying zone, uncertain zone.
When you're comfortable working, when everything is fine, that time we will not have that kind of faith. God says, I want to squeeze it out, that fear, and fill that place with my faith in you.
I may have little faith. I will talk to you about the levels of faith. That's the last point that I have. Uncertain zones actually stretches your faith level. You see the next page? You see there are different levels of faith. This is known as faithometer. Not thermometer. Faithometer. Everyone has different faith, starting from weak faith to temporary faith to active faith, to strong faith, to great faith, to unfeigned faith, to divine faith. There are various references for that, but I don't have time now to explain all those. That is why Jesus looked at them then said, you have little faith. That means their faith level, their faithometer was down there. Once we were with no faith, but because of grace of God, we have come to faith. But that level has to grow on a daily basis. Little faith and great faith, genuine faith, holy faith, and goes on up as we grow in our spiritual life. And when does it grow? When we are in these trying zones. The Lord, now let me explain to us what I am trying to say. These people are believers with Jesus. They believed in Jesus. They knew that he's the Messiah. They have seen miracles happening right in front of their eyes. 5 loaves of bread being multiplied and many healed, this and that. But they have not understood who he is. Look at the question they are asking. Come to Matthew chapter 8, verse 26. What are they saying? The men were amazed and asked, what kind of man is this? Isn't it interesting? They were calling him master. Now they're calling, what kind of man is this? Even the winds and waves obey him. Oh, they have not seen somebody who has commanded the winds and they stopped. They've seen some miracle healers here and there. The rabbis or some other scenes are there. But they have never seen somebody commanding the nature and nature obeys to that. That's the kind of level the Lord wanted them to grow. I know you are little faith. I know I want you to know that I can do greater things than what you have experienced now, what you're thinking of. I want to do greater things for you. Have your faith level grown? Are you able to stretch your faith level? And the faith to proclaim calmness. Matthew chapter 8, verse 27. What did Jesus do? When the disciples were shouting, what did Jesus do? He didn't shout at them like many of the parents do when the children do all kinds of things and then we get upset with them and then try to solve the problem. But Jesus is different. Our Lord is different. He calms the storm and then turns back to them and says, where is your faith? So he calms the storm. The Lord wants us to develop that kind of faith so that we can proclaim. Look at the mountain and say, move off. Look at the sickness and say, be healed. Do we have that faith to proclaim? Yes, Pastor, I can pray. I believe. But can I do that? No, that is done in first century. Oh, that's done by great men of God who are anointed. I'm an ordinary believer, Pastor. No, the Lord can do greater things through you and me if you just believe. The Lord wants us. He demonstrated right in front of them and said, be still. And that happened. Let me pick up one example and stop my message this afternoon. This is a story which is, I think, 17 or 18 years old, probably. I heard the story 17, 18 years old ago. That's why I'm telling you. One of my dad's cousin who was in a Muslim country, I don't want to name that place. So, very hardcore place. And then he was asked to, he heard a story about a man who was from a Buddhist background, who was working under a sheikh. Sheikh means the big lords in the Arab countries. So, he was a faithful servant, so he was a faithful person. The sheikh liked him very much. One day he fell sick. He had incurable disease. And the sheikh tried his best to save him. He took him to the best doctors of that place. He was a rich man, so he took him everywhere. But the doctor said that he's going to die in a few days' time. To cut the story short, he was finally left to himself and they didn't know what to do. But one day he came to know there's a man of God who prayed in the name of Jesus in the Muslim world. And for the sake of secrecy, I'm not telling the name of that man of God. And then he somehow went to his place secretly without anybody knowing. If somebody comes to know, the pastor will be in danger and he also will be in danger. So he went there secretly for prayer. And when the pastor looked at him
and asked him, where are you coming? He said, I'm coming from the Sheikh. And the pastor was shaken. When he said that I'm coming from Sheikh, he was shaken. Because he knows that if somebody comes to know about me, I'll be killed. The pastor shared him the gospel. He said, brother, I can pray for you. You can go and have a test. Don't publish it. He prayed for him and he left. And then he found out that something has happened to his body. And then they did the checkup and they found out that he was 100% healed. The story doesn't stop there. The story starts there. After that, the Sheikh comes to know and he was excited. How did that happen? Then he told him, somebody by the name, a pastor prayed for me and I was healed in the name of Jesus. Sheikh was shaken when he heard about Jesus. How come that? Don't tell that to anybody. Otherwise, I'll be in danger. But Sheikh loved him, so he kept him in his house. But slowly, slowly, everyone came to know that he was healed because the doctors had given him in writing that he'll be dying. Finally, this man was questioned by the Muslim leaders of that place. They surrounded him and they brought around 50 people with incurable diseases. Skin disease. The skin was mutilated and almost they were in a dying stage. And they know that no medicine can cure them. So they deliberately brought all those 50 people there and all the Muslim leaders were surrounding him and asked him, tell us who healed you? He said, I can say only one thing. Jesus healed me. I did not know how. A man of God prayed for me in Jesus' name and I was healed. And they were furious when they heard the name of Jesus. Finally, to test him, they said, okay, you say your Jesus healed you? Come on, pray for them. And let's see that if they are healed, then we can listen to you. Otherwise, you would be in trouble. This man had not gone to a Bible college. He has not attended many prayer meetings. He doesn't know anything. But that was the trying zone, uncertain, risky zone for him. You may ask a question, why did God allow that situation in his life? This man was shivering actually. What they have done is they tied him at the back of a car, they dragged him, and he was bleeding from here to here. But still he said, Jesus has healed him. And then he was standing there, looking at him, what he's going to do. He didn't know what to say. He just knew in the name of Jesus. That's all he knew. He went to the first sick person and laid his hands on him and said, in Jesus' name. Suddenly, immediately, that man was healed. He went to the second person. He just said, in the name of Jesus. And likewise, 50 people were healed in the name of Jesus. And all the Muslim leaders looked at him. They couldn't say any word. They dispersed from there. And this man started his ministry in that part of the world. Why did God allow him to have that kind of a situation? He was stretching his faith level. This afternoon, I want to stop here. But I want to ask each one of you, where is our faith level? Are we in the lowest level? We may be walking with Jesus like the disciples walked, seeing all miracles, coming to church and attending, paying tithe and all kinds of things, reading Bible day and night, even fasting for 40 days. But the Lord is asking, where is your faith level? I want to stretch it a little further. In 2019, I want to use you in a mighty way. That is why I'm putting you in this trying zone, uncertain zone. It may be uncertain zone for you, but I am in control of this zone. It may be a testing time for you, but for me, it's a building time for me so that I can build you up in faith. From outside world, people may look at you and say, this man is gone. This family is gone. No hope for them. But the Lord says, don't look at them. You are in the trying zone. I have separated you from the crowd. And you don't listen to their voice. You listen to me. I am doing something inside you. I am doing something inside your family's life. You may be physically down many times and thinking, Lord, why is it happening to me? Why is this happening to me? How long? The Lord says, in the faithometer level, I want to grow you. I want to build you up from no faith to little faith to great faith to genuine faith to holy faith. This is the level the Lord wants. The Lord wants us to understand who this Jesus is. He can do that. He can do this. He can do all. He wants us to proclaim with our mouth. Just like Jesus stood there and said, peace, be still. Can you say that? Yes, you can say that. 2019, let us speak with our mouth and say, in the name of Jesus, be healed. In the name of Jesus, let the mountains move off. Do I have that faith? Or are we like the baby Christians still crying out? The Lord wants us to grow. Don't be just satisfied with a little faith level. The Lord wants us to grow. And the Lord can do it. The Lord is doing. And you will see greater things happening in 2019. Let's close our eyes.